Hello, my name is Piper Kerman, and I am the author of the memoir, Orange is the New Black, My Year in a Women's Prison. Now, a little more than 20 years ago, when I was in my early 20s, I committed a crime. I was involved in a relationship with a drug trafficker, and at her request, I carried a bag of money from Chicago to Brussels. And I did this despite the fact that I was a fortunate young woman with a university education. And this was truly a low point in my judgment and my morals. Now, a decade after I carried that bag of drug money, I found myself walking through the gates of an enormous, vicious razor wire fence. And I was about to begin serving a year in prison for that crime that I'd committed a decade before. There it is, Danbury, Connecticut, 2004. I walked through that razor wire fence and I heard it closing behind me. And I was very, very scared on that day. And I have to say that the prison guards who transformed me from Piper Kerman into prisoner 1118724, they didn't do a lot to make me any less scared. Let's put it that way. I was then put into the prison unit where I would do my time. And there were hundreds and hundreds of other women there, and they were all strangers to me. And right away I saw that I was wearing a different uniform than they were wearing, and on my feet were little canvas slippers, and on their feet were big black steel-toed shoes. And the women began to approach me in their big black steel-toed shoes, and I was scared. And they said things to me like, "Do you need some toothpaste? Do you need some shower shoes? Because there is a wicked foot fungus in those showers. Do you need me to make you a cup of instant coffee? Because Kerman, you are quaking in your slippers. Look, this is a really bad day. Tomorrow will be a tiny bit better." And what I was experiencing was something that I would actually witness hundreds and hundreds of other times over the course of that year. This phenomenon of the welcome wagon, when the women would step up every time that there was a new prisoner and make sure that she had the things that she so desperately needed. Things like toothpaste, things like shampoo, a stamp, a precious stamp, along with an envelope and a paper and pen. All these things that the prison certainly does not provide. And so the last thing that I expected on my first day in prison was to experience kindness at the hands of the other prisoners, because of course, prisons are associated with violence and depravity. But that is exactly what I found on that first day, kindness. And so I crawled into my bunk, the top bunk, on that first night in prison. And I crawled in there early, long before they turned the lights out. I had found an old copy of Pride and Prejudice, so I had Jane Austen to comfort me. And of course I was wondering, what do I have to do for that toothpaste? And the answer is, nothing. Just return it in kind when you are able. And I have to say, I was exhausted. And I was in despair as well. I was saying to myself, I don't know how I am going to do this. But even that first night, my first night in prison, I recognized that the experience of incarceration was not going to be what I expected it to be, right? So the women that I met in prison, they schooled me. They schooled me. And some of them befriended me. And they helped me survive in ways both great and also small. And they shared their own survival with me. And for that, I am very, very grateful. My connection to those other women, that is what helped me be human in that place, a prison, which is designed to take your humanity away from you. My connection to those other women was what prompted me and pushed me to be my best self in a place that tells you every single day that you will always be defined by your worst act. And my connection to those other women was what helped me to comprehend the harm of my own actions, because many of those other women, their lives had been devastated by substance abuse and by addiction. And that was really what helped me understand that my choices had furthered other people's suffering. I have to emphasize, it was that connection that fostered that understanding and not the cage that we shared. So I came home from prison in 2005, and I hoped that by sharing my story that I might get people to think differently about who is in prison and why are they there and what really happens to them behind the walls of a prison or a jail, because it is a world that is very intentionally hidden away from the public view. Now, I chose to call my book Orange is the New Black for several reasons. First and foremost, a play on the notorious orange jumpsuit that we associate with prisons and prisoners, and also a play on the fashion cliché. So this year, purple might be the new black, and last year, gray was the new black. Perhaps next year, turquoise will be the new black. But what I wanted to signal with this title, that this is not just a book about prisoners, this is a book about women. And the other thing that I wanted to convey with the title, Orange is the New Black, has to do with a number, a very large number, and that is the number 800,000. 800,000 is the percentage increase in the United States, which is where I'm from, in the incarceration of women over the last 30 years. Now, all over the world, the incarceration of women has skyrocketed. Here in Latin America, since 2006, the number of women in prison has more than doubled. So, more and more likely, everywhere around the globe, the person wearing that orange jumpsuit or any prison uniform is likely to be a woman, right? And so that 800,000 was very important. So, who are these women that we're locking up, left and right? These women that I'm showing you, this is Carmen, and this is Marietta, and this is Betty. And these are women who come to the Women's Prison Association, which is an NGO in New York City, and they come to make very important changes in their life after prison. Now, around the world, women in prison are most likely to be incarcerated for nonviolent crimes, for very low-level crimes, and most often for drug crimes, right? And I think that women prisoners offer a very crystallizing example of the people that we now put into prisons and jails who we never would have put in prisons and jails before, right? All of those nonviolent folks. Now, the women that we put in prisons and jails around the world overwhelmingly come from the poorest communities and from the most vulnerable families. And you do need to know that when you lock up a woman, no matter how you feel about that woman in prison, know that her sentence is punishing other people as well. Most women in prison are mothers. Most of those mothers are the moms of young children. And too often, when we lock up a mother, we leave her children unprotected. I think you can see by those pictures of Carmen and of Marietta and of Betty, that even a mom who has been in trouble is still a person whose family loves and needs her. Now, here he is. I often say this is the hero of the piece. This is my then fiancé and now husband, Larry. And this is the day that I was released from prison. I woke up on March 4th, 2005, and I was being held in a horrible federal jail in Chicago. It is a high-rise, high-security place, 700 men, about 35 women. It is the worst place I've ever been in my life. And I woke up that day, I knew I was supposed to be released from prison, but they would not confirm that they were going to let me go. So I watched Martha Stewart get released on the 6 a.m. news, and I waited. And finally, at 11 o'clock, I got the call. Kerman, pack out. And they took me down to receiving and disbursement, which is where every prisoner comes in and every prisoner goes out, just like a warehouse. And they said to me, we don't have any women's clothes, so here are the smallest men's clothes that we have. And here is a windbreaker. It was Chicago. It was March. And here is $28. And they took me down in an elevator to the alleyway door. And they opened up that alleyway door and they said, adios. And I was 800 miles away from my home. And I was so very, very, very lucky because this man was waiting impatiently at the front door to take me home to New York. But what if he had not been? I think about that all the time. I am much more fortunate than most of the women that I did time with. Many of them were not going home to a safe and stable place to live, or a good job, or health insurance. Now, all around the world, criminal justice systems offer stark examples of inequality in our communities and in our societies. Poor people are very harshly punished, and sometimes for very minor crimes, while rich people rarely face the consequences of their transgressions. In the United States, where I live, 80% of people who are accused of a crime are too poor to afford to pay a lawyer for their defense. Now, I offer you this observation. A prison is, by design, intended to marginalize people. You know, people commit a crime, they do something that we don't like, they transgress against society in some way, and we say to them, we are going to put you to the side, in a prison, in a jail, for the term of your sentence. And then, maybe, we will allow you to return to the community. But I would say, after doing my time, and after visiting many, many men's and women's prisons, that prisons are filled with people who had experienced marginalization long before they ever walked through those big, vicious razor wire gates. And that can be marginalization based on poverty. It can be based on racism, can be based on mental illness, on homophobia. There are many, many ways that we push people to the edges of society. But when a prison cell is our answer, our solution to those problems, we are failing as a society. We need criminal justice systems to deliver justice and not to be implements of oppression. Now, the women that I did time with, they made an indelible impression on me, as indelible as a prison tattoo. And we shared crowded dorms and absolutely no privacy. We shared 8 numbers instead of a name, and we shared really bad food. But more importantly, we shared a deep reserve of humor. and incredible creativity in the face of adverse circumstances. And we shared the will to preserve and to maintain our humanity despite the prison system's imperative to crush that humanity. And I have to tell you that when I found that I was making those kinds of connections, what I found is that it will move you to change the world or to do your very best to change the world. Because when we allow ourselves to be truly connected to other people, inequality becomes intolerable. Now, this is Shalanda, another of the women who comes to work with us at the Women's Prison Association. And this is her with her beautiful family on what is obviously a really great day. Now, for me, this is a really great day. I get to be here with all of you, and I get to be talking about these people and these issues that are so very important to me. This is not my worst day. This is not the day that I carried that bag of drug money. This is not the day that I was sentenced to prison or the day that I started doing my time. Those were really bad days. And what I want for Shalanda and her family, and really for everybody who is accused or convicted of a crime, is for them to be recognized not only for their worst day, their biggest mistake, but also for their best day and for the best things they're capable of in the future. So I ask this simple thing of all of you. Please make sure that those who are accused or convicted of a crime get that opportunity to be judged, not only for their worst day, but also for their best, because Shalanda deserves it, and I think that everyone does. Thank you.
Wow, wow. Este año lo que queremos hacer es algo un poco más interactivo. Tenemos micrófonos en algunos pasillos. Van a haber momentos que la gente que quiera hacer una pregunta se puede formar. Dos preguntas muy breves. No sé si hay alguien que quiera hacer una pregunta a Piper. Si no, recordarles que Piper, Lawrence Cross y el doctor Herzog van a estar en la librería firmando libros y conversando con ustedes. Otro aplauso, por favor. Thank you very much.